Would you stand to your feet and would you honor the ministry gift of Dr. Marilyn Hickey as she comes to share God's word with us? Come on, let's give God praise and honor that in the beginning of 2016, we're putting God's word first in our lives tonight in Jesus' name, amen. We're open to receive from God in Jesus' name, amen.
You can be seated. It's very exciting for me to be here, and I'll tell you in particular why. Because wherever the Word of God is really established and honored, that's where you see breakthroughs and miracles. Now, let me tell you, the first year I was married, I heard Kenneth Hagin speak. And it was just a little church, a little four-square church in Denver, Colorado. And I thought, if the Word can work like that for him, it can work that way for me. And so here I am. I am 84 and a half, and I see how the Word works. I see how the Word works. And what I love about this church is that you've always emphasized the Word, speaking the Word, living the Word, you know, practicing the Word. I don't know if you know how blessed you are to be in a faith church, but you are really blessed to be a part of this church, really blessed. And they've always taught the Word, and I'm telling you, the Word produces. So put your hand on your heart. Say, I won't forget. The Word produces. Now, I like this. Jesus is the living Word. Amen? And so this is what I do at the beginning of my day. When I get up, the first thing I do is I say, good morning, Father. Good morning, Jesus. Good morning, Holy Spirit. This is your beloved Marilyn. Now you say, well, I think that's arrogant. Do you? Do you know 42 times in the New Testament, he calls you beloved? So are you? So stand up. We'll tell him good evening. Okay. Put up both your hands. Say, good evening, Father. Good evening, Jesus. Good evening, Holy Spirit. This is your beloved. Amen. Amen. And he gives his beloved an outstanding new year, right? So put your hand on your heart again. Say, this year is a supernatural year because I'm his beloved. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Now, I have just come. Last year, I had the opportunity to be in 14 countries, but I just have to share a quick miracle for you because I got to go to Tibet. This would have been about 5 weeks ago. Now, I don't know if you know anything about Tibet. It is a Buddhist country. They were taken over by China in 59. And it's been a very hard time. Maybe you heard about the Dalai Lama. You know, he was not allowed to come back. He is in, I think, India is where he lives. So we took a whole team over there to do prayer walking. And you believe in prayer, right? Yes. And you believe in walking in prayer. Yes. And so here we go. It's 12,000 feet high. You can hardly breathe. It's bitter cold. And we are walking, you know, and asking Jesus to move in this country. Well, I had a wonderful guide, a young guide, and he said to me, have you ever heard of four brothers and one wife? I said, I don't think so. He said, well, in Tibet, four brothers marry one woman. Oh, my goodness. You know, and I almost thought, yuck, say yuck. Imagine that poor woman. I said, well, why do they do that? He said, because then all the children work the farm. So he said, I'm not sure who my father is, but one of the men I look like. And so, you know, you're thinking, wow, this is unusual. We're here to do prayer walking. We're believing for Tibet to really know Jesus. So, you know, we were told you cannot pass out tracts. You cannot witness to people. But I love this about God. He thinks you can do anything. So stand up. Put your hand on your heart again. Say, God thinks I can do anything. Amen. So you can be seated. So You know, one of the men on our trip of the 104 people, he had gotten 4 Tibetan Bibles, you know, New Testaments in the Tibetan language. But he was just kind of waiting to see how God would use it. So our guide said to me one day, Marilyn, can you tell me about Jesus? I said, well, I can give you a New Testament, which will really help you with it. I said, in fact, I have 4. He said, well, I'll take the first one, then I'll take you to our head lama, and you can give him the other 3. And so we got to go to the head lama, that would be like the Dalai Lama, and present him with those 3 Bibles, and he has started a Bible study with all of the monks in Tibet. Oh, I thought, oh God, for last year you saved the best miracle till the last. Amen. Now, let's remember that God thinks we can do anything because Christ in us is the hope of glory. And what I want to share with you tonight is something that has produced in my life for many years. Now, when I started on television, you know, everybody said to me, you will never make it. You're not television material. Stay with the radio. Nobody will watch you. And those people who said that to me were television people, secular, and none of them are in television now, and I've been in television 44 years. So I say that to you because of the Word of God and who Jesus is inside you. And I want to share this special scripture before I start into this gorgeous prayer pattern for your year that makes it a supernatural year. But I love this scripture in 2 Corinthians 2:14. It says, thanks be unto God who always leads us to triumph in Christ and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. Now, what is that saying to you? The game is not over till you win. So in every situation this year, you are supposed to win. So stand up again. You say, is this an exercise class? Yes, it is. Put your hand on your heart. Say, I will not forget. 2 Corinthians 2:14, which says to me, thanks be unto God who always, always leads me to triumph in Christ and through me diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. Now keep your hand there. Say, the game is not over until I win. Amen. Amen. We win. We take the word of God. That makes us a winner. Now tonight, I like to have volunteers because if you can see this, it helps you receive it and do it. Now, you know, the word, we hear the word, but we have to speak the word. Isn't that true? And I have found that the word demonstrates. And, you know, sometimes, and I've gone to Pakistan, I'll be going again. This will be my 9th time. And sometimes when I've gotten up to preach, I feel as spiritual as a mouse. For one thing, I have jet lag. I'm tired. I look at all these people out there, and the last time I was there, I had 230,000 people. And I look at them and think, I don't feel spiritual. I don't feel like anything. I'm just tired. I don't even know if my brain is alive. And this is what the Lord said to me. He said, it doesn't matter how you feel. It's not your name. It's my name. And so it doesn't matter how you feel. What matters is his word and his name. Amen? Amen. And so that's so key for us. So I want you to see who Jesus is in you every day. So this is a very important prayer plan. I've used this. I've seen success in nations all over the world with people every place. Amen? So I need 7 volunteers who will come and stand with me for a long time. So if you just come up, that's great. Here comes 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's see it. Come on up and stand up here with me. Okay, come right to the platform. Okay, now this is a standing long time, so maybe I better take these, but thank you. I appreciate you. Okay, now I want you to stand. If you would stand right here and face the people like this. Okay, then I want you to stand behind him. That's great. Then I want you to stand where I'm standing and face this wall, okay? And then I want you to come and stand and face him. So you're going to face him like we're making a square. That's good. Okay, and then I need you to stand, if you stand a little closer, and face his back. Okay? That's good. Yes. And I want you to stand behind him, and I need you to stand right behind him. Now, when you look at this, this prayer pattern shows you who Jesus is in everything in your life every day. Because it's not just, well, when I get in trouble, I'm going to call on him. It's a lifestyle. Amen? And you want to live a lifestyle of Jesus. And I hear this and in your worship tonight, that's so wonderful. I hear more emphasis on worshiping Jesus, more teaching on Jesus than I've heard for a long time. Is that awesome? And so who is he? Well, let's see who he is in us. We know he's Christ in us, the hope of glory. But the prayer that I learned and did and see so productive in my life is taken from the Old Testament. Now, I think I taught you last year when I was here that the Old Testament is all about Jesus. And people don't read the Old Testament often. But when you read the New Testament, you're reading a lot of the Old Testament. Because the New Testament, two-thirds, is quoted from the Old, right? And the Old Testament is full of Jesus. And so we see this pattern of Jesus and how they knew him and who he is inside us with the tabernacle prayer. Now, let me talk to you about the tabernacle. God has always desired to be where his people are. He wants to live in their midst. So when they came out of Egypt, he set up a place where he could meet with them and they could meet with him and he could be real to them and alive to them. That's why when you get born again, he comes inside you. He is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And so he wants us to see who he is inside. So when they set up the tabernacle, they did everything. And I need the, let's see, where are my books and things? Yeah. They did everything according to a pattern, every piece of furniture. Now, this is something, if you put that up here for me, that's great. Thank you. This is something I want you to see, that every piece of furniture that you're going to see tonight in the prayer pattern is in the book of Revelation. So you say, well, you're just teaching Old Testament. I'm teaching Bible. And so in the book of Revelation, it talks about the Ark of the Covenant. In the book of Revelation, it talks about the washing of the water of the Word. Everything was taken from that pattern. So it's not just something that Moses kind of dreamed up, but it was something that was to bring them victory in the wilderness, take them into the promised land, and take us into the victory that he has for us every day in Jesus. Everybody say, in Jesus. When you go through the New Testament and you mark every place it says in Christ, my goodness, it never stops, right? So it's in Jesus. Everybody say in Jesus. So he told them, put a white linen curtain around this, a real tall wall, and it will only have one door. And so I tell you how that door is, and that one door, they couldn't just come in on any direction, only in one door. And Jesus said, I am the door. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So I'm going to kind of tell you some things because I go to Muslim nations a lot. And don't ask me how I get in there. And my biggest meetings are in Muslim nations. And Muslims hate women. And they hate Christians. And I'm an old woman and a Christian. And they love me. It is just awesome. And so they will say to me, so I'm kind of giving you a secret. They will say to me, well, don't you think Allah and God are the same? So this is what I say. Because there's only one door. Everybody say one door. Say Jesus is the door. So I said, well, I've read most of the Quran. And I said, do you know in the Quran it says to kill Christians and Jews? They say, it says that? I said, yes, it does. And do you believe Allah wrote the Quran? Yes. They said, he did. I said, well, I've read the Bible many times, and it never says kill Jews and Christians. So do you think they're the same? Because there's one door. Everybody say, one door. His name is Jesus. He said, I am the door. So the first thing they saw when they came in that one door, and this is so important, they saw this huge piece of furniture that I tell you about in the study guide for this prayer time, and it was called the Brazen Altar. So put your hand on your heart. Say, I won't forget. When I come into his presence, I see the brazen altar. Now, these two pieces of furniture, which are outside under the natural sun, were brass, because brass had to do with judgment. And so what did Jesus do? He took the judgment of your sin. So the first piece of furniture they saw was this big brass altar. It was so big, you could put every piece of furniture in it. The first thing we see in Jesus, that he died for our sins. He is the perfect sacrifice. He is the Lamb of God. Amen?
Amen.
So we come into his presence through his blood. So put your hand on your heart. Say, I won't forget.
I won't forget.
I come into his presence,
into his presence.
Through his blood.
Through his blood.
And that's the most important thing of all, that he died for our sins and arose from the dead. So we come in, we see that huge piece of furniture. It took the judgment of all of our sin. It took the judgment of the past sin, the present sin, the future sin. The blood speaks better things for us. Amen. And so I'm in the blood, you're in the blood, and the blood is speaking for us tonight. And then when I go from this piece of furniture, then there is a brass laver. And, you know, this brass laver, it's interesting that all of these things out here that are in the sunlight are made of brass, their judgment. But there are two things that help cleanse you. There is the blood of Jesus. And when they pierced his side, out came water and blood, right? And so we have the washing of the water of the word. And have you ever noticed when you're reading the Bible, I like to read the Bible through every year, that a lot of times you get cleaned up. You know, you'd like to go slap somebody. And then, you know, that scripture in Titus 3:2 is so disgusting. It says to speak evil of no one, to be patient and gentle and show all humility to all men. Oh! And so you read the Bible and it cleanses you as well as the blood of Jesus. Amen. And just don't forget, out of his side came water and blood. Now, I love this. This beautiful brazen laver, and you know, you see the picture of it, and here it would hold water, but it was made out of the mirrors of the women. So when they left Egypt, if you remember, they took a lot of jewels, they took a lot of gold, they took a lot of brass, they took a lot of linen, and the women had mirrors, and they were made of brass. So they said, we need brass to make the brazen laver, because the Bible has shown us in Revelation that there is the cleansing through the water, the washing of water. So these women gave their mirrors. Now, isn't it something that in James it says the Bible is a mirror? And so we look into the Bible, and we see who we really are. I see where God thinks I can do anything through Christ who strengthens me. You know, I wanted to go to Sudan. And, you know, I wanted to go to Iran. They tell you, you can't go to Iran. Nobody can go to Iran. And I tried for 4 years. And I said, I'm a tourist. They said, we know who you are. You're not a tourist. But, you know, God thinks you can do anything. And the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So I didn't give up, because people said to me, you shouldn't go anyway, you'll probably get killed. But I kept having this passion to go to Iran. So I go to Brazil, and we're doing a big meeting in Rio de Janeiro, and the man who had a tour agency who helped us with ours, the Portuguese man, said, you know, I have a tour agency in Iran. Would you like to go to Iran? Well, is the Pope a Catholic? Yes, I'd like to go to Iran. And I got to go in twice, because the Bible says I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So when I look into the mirror of his word, yeah, sometimes it cleanses me, but sometimes, most of the time, it just encourages me. Don't give up. The game is not over till you win. Don't give up. The game is not over till you win. So all of that is out here. Now, I want to say something else to you. I believe God wants people, Christians, his people, to have health to the end of their lives. So I'm going to share a couple things, you know, because people say, well, you know, as you get older, you have allergies and you have weaknesses. Your family had arthritis. But, you know, I have a new father and he doesn't have arthritis. And so as you go into those years, you need to take what the word says about you. So, you know, I have a little hearing aid on tonight, on my right ear. So I went in to have a checkup. And so I hadn't been in about this hearing aid for 4 years. A lot of times I don't wear it. So they said to me, well, how are you doing? I said, well, I think I'm hearing better. And the doctor looks at me and says, you're 84 and you're hearing better? Well, we'll test you. I know he thought, I've got a crazy one today. And so he tests me. He said, this is the strangest thing. You're hearing 35% better than you were for 4 years ago. Now, who is this? This is the word of God. The word is life. Is that true? And the word is an anointing. And the word is quickening. And when I tell people, they say, well, how can you do all these things? How can you be this busy? I say, it's the word. They look at me like, yeah, you're crazy. But folks, it's true. And you're in a word church. You are really blessed. Okay, so here we have the washing of the water of the word. We can look into the mirror of the word and see what he has for us. Another thing, you know, I had to go about my teeth. I have them cleaned 2 or 3 times a year. And they said, you know, your gums are better than they were 7 months ago. Folks, did you know you could get better? And not bitter, because that's the word. And the word is life to us. So wonderful. So we have all of this on the outside. We have the word for our body. But also, oh, and this is beautiful, because I go into a lot more detail in here and with the DVD. But when you go into the holy place is covered. So out here, you had the sunlight. But when you go into the holy place, what's going to be the light? And in the holy place, they had a lampstand. So I need you to be the lampstand. Would you hold your arms up? Isn't he a great lampstand? And so in the holy place, they had this golden lampstand, because all the furniture out here is brass, has to do with judgment, blood, water, cleansing. But in here, everything is gold. Now, I believe this is your soul area. So put your hands down, because I don't want to pray for you later that you have a problem. Okay. So I go in here, and I have the light of the candlestick. Now, I believe there is light for our souls because of our minds. Amen? And if you look at the candlestick, you can see that there are 7 anointings. There's the candlestick with the anointing of the oil in the center, but then there's wisdom and understanding and counsel and might and knowledge and fear of the Lord. Because you can have wisdom in your mind for something, but if you don't know how to speak it, you can get in trouble. And so I'll just tell you a little thing about Sarah. When she was growing up, you know, she got into some trouble one day, and I was so upset with her. Well, actually, I opened her car door, and beer cans fell out. And so I cried, how could you do this? She said, "You don't understand how hard it is at our school. Everybody drinks." I said, "Well, why don't you come and tell me?" She said, "You never listen. You just preach to me." That was understanding. So I understood it's right to talk to her these things, but let her talk. And so, you know, I do that even to this day. She just had her 48th birthday. She'll call me up and she'll say, "Mom, do you mind if I unwind?" And she'll go on and on and on and on and on and on. Then when she's through, I don't say anything. She said, "Well, what do you think?" "Oh, you want to know?" Wisdom and understanding. Counsel and might. Because sometimes we have to confront people. And that's not easy. So, you know, I think, especially sometimes with staff, you know, and being a pastor's wife for many years, let somebody else do it. You let them do it. I don't like to confront people, you know. And so, you know, you have to take the anointing that you have the counsel, but you have the might to do it with. Aren't you glad you came tonight? Look at someone. Say, "Honey, this is really good for you." And so, you know, we need to confront. He'll give us the might to do it with. But then this beautiful anointing on this candlestick, it says something else. Knowledge and the fear of God. Now, this concerns me because I think a lot of people have knowledge of God, but they don't fear Him. Oh, yeah, they know they shouldn't take drugs. They know they shouldn't drink. They know they shouldn't be sleeping around. But, you know, they know what God says, but they don't fear Him. And the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. And so we want to have knowledge with the fear of God. Amen? And so that's so good that you're getting knowledge, but you fear God, you respect God, and that's the beginning of wisdom. And I believe this is going to be your wisest year you've ever had. Amen. So what do I say in the morning when I get up? Oh, my goodness, my mind. I say, I have the mind of Christ. Jesus has made unto me wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. And there are days when I don't think that looks true, but I say it anyway because I have the mind of Christ. So stand up. We need to just kind of walk this through. I'm concerned you're not going to get it. Okay. Say, "Father, I thank you. I have the blood of Jesus that cleanses me from all sin. I repent. I have faith in His blood, and I'm cleansed. Father, I thank you for a hunger for the Word of God. This year, I can't keep out of my Bible. I'm always in my Bible." Amen. Amen. Now put your hand on your head. Say, "Father, the mind of Christ belongs to me. You are made unto me wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption." Amen. You can be seated. So we're in our soul area, our mind. The candlestick is the light. But also there's a table of shewbread. So if you put your hands out like you're a table, and it's gold too. But it has 12 loaves on it. And it's called the bread of His presence. And I go into a lot of detail here. It's so interesting. And it has the bread of faces. It's also called faces. So these 12 loaves had to do with 12 tribes. And so their face was ever before the Lord because He loved them all. And so it had to do with relationship, you know, to God. And I believe some of the most challenging things in my life have been people. Right? And so relationships, they can be so hard on you. But that's where our emotions get touched. And so it's very important that we surrender our emotions to the Lord every day too. Lord, I want to think what you think. I want to feel what you feel. Right now, I want to slap them sideways. But help me to feel what you feel about this person, that I can do and say what is right. So I'm going to tell you a little thing that happened to me many years when I first started to travel. And, you know, women weren't traveling and speaking. And here God is throwing me out in that arena. And I got invited to a charismatic conference to speak. I couldn't believe it. And I was on radio. I wasn't on television. And so they took up an offering for me at the end for the radio. Oh, I was so thrilled. You know, I'd never had that happen to me. And so I came home. They said, we'll mail it to you. And so I came home. I'm expecting it. Didn't come. So our office, and I had one person who volunteered to help me in the office, called and said, you know, we haven't received the offering. Oh, they said, we'll check that out. We'll see that you get it. It hasn't been mailed yet. So we still didn't get it. So after another month, they called again. They said, oh, we don't know what's happened, but I never got it. Okay, and the Lord said to me, if you give it to them as an offering, then you're sowing a seed, and I can give you a harvest. And so that's the first offering I ever gave that was given to me. And folks, I've had blessings through the years. Television's expensive. I had a woman in Uganda who felt led to give me $1 million. I felt led to receive it. But it started by surrendering my emotions to him. Then he could bless me and prosper me. So stand up. Because this is a real serious part of our soul. Right? So put your hand on your heart. Say, Father. I'm surrendering my emotions to you. I thank you that you will help me in relationships to be wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Now remember, I'm doing this every day. So I'm coming, Jesus. You know, I have your blood for cleansing. I have your word, you know, for cleansing. I surrender my mind for the mind of Christ. I surrender my emotions. But there's a third thing in your soul area that's very important, and that's your will. And so your will is key in this. So God, not my will, but thine be done. But half the time I think mine is better. And so surrendering your will to him, and to do it early in the morning is good before you get caught up in things. So I'm going to share an experience I had in Bethlehem. Now, I went to Bethlehem on Christmas. So Christmas Eve in Bethlehem, and they can hold like 40, 50,000 people. But it's mostly Muslims out there, and it's, you know, very secular. They're selling flowers, picking up girls, selling candy. You know, it's not very good. But they allow different churches to come in and sing that night for 20 minutes because it's Christmas Eve. So I said, well, I don't sing, but I like to teach, and I'd like 20 minutes to teach. They said, no. I said, I can't sing. So they said, you can't do it. But, you know, I took that scripture, you know, you always win. And so I just kept pressing. Finally, they said, okay, 20 minutes. Oh, I'm so excited because we have all these Muslims there. I'm going to show them how to receive Jesus in 20 minutes. This is awesome. So I stood up, and the Muslim call to prayer came. Oh, God, you have to stop. And it lasts 10 minutes. And I'm so upset. Oh, I'm so upset. This is my shot. I've got the message, and now I have to wait for this. And this is what the Holy Spirit said to me. He said, I can take a lemon and make it lemonade. So I said, I'll take the lemonade. Now, I'm surrendering my will to him because, as I said, I'm really upset about this, and the Lord showed me what to do. So when they finished the Muslim call to prayer, now remember, you got 40,000 people there, most of them are Muslim, I said, you know, I'm so comfortable when I hear the Muslim call to prayer because I go to all these countries, Muslim countries, I named them Pakistan and Sudan, all these countries, and I said, I just love Muslims, and Muslims love me. And they clapped, and I clapped, and then I said, and I'm here to give Muslims a hope. And I told them about how Jesus died for their sins and arose from the dead. And I said, and you can have him tonight. So I said, if you'd like to have Jesus, wave at me. Well, hard to see 40,000 people. But they were very excited, and they waved at me and prayed the sinner's prayer. Folks, if you'll surrender your will to God, he can take a lemon and make it lemonade. He can give you favor and anointing in special places this year and prosper you beyond your fondest dreams. Amen. So stand up. Now that golden altar of incense, that's where we're surrendering our will. Say, Father,
Father,
I'm surrendering my will.
I'm surrendering my will.
For this day,
this night,
because I know,
you can make everything work together
for good. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. So we surrender our will to him. Okay, you can be seated. Now, in your study guide, this is a golden piece of furniture. It was called the Golden Altar of Incense. And this is where they prayed. And so that beautiful aroma of prayer came into the presence of God. And see, as a church, you're entering into prayer. I heard what you're doing. You're fanatics. And you're really entering into prayer for this new year. Is that right? And so what are you? You're at the golden altar of incense, surrendering your will to pray. And, you know, it's not always comfortable for me to pray, but I have learned if you have a prayer pattern, you do better with it. And that's why I have a simple prayer pattern that I like to pray. Now, I'm going to give you something else that I think is very important. And as spirit-filled believers, we need to pray in tongues. Amen? Because Romans 8, 26, 27, 28 says we don't know how to pray for things as we ought. But the Spirit himself prays through us with groanings. He searches the heart and prays through us with groanings that cannot be thought out. And so when you pray in the Spirit, Romans 8, 28 says he makes all things work together for good. So praying in the Spirit will cause things to work together for good. Amen. So sometimes I don't know how to pray for people. So I spend a lot of time praying in the Spirit. And now I sing in the Spirit. Sometimes I get up in the morning, and one morning I got up and the Lord said to me, I danced over you in the night. I thought, you did? And I began to sing in tongues. Do you think that helped me? Do you think that was a blessing? But I can tell you, I've met with people. A daughter of one of my friends was into a real bad sexual relationship. She's in the service. And so we just took an hour, and we just prayed in tongues. And the daughter called her 2 weeks later and had broken up the relationship. See, he searches the heart. He knows the mind of God. And so I do a lot of praying in the Spirit. So look at someone, say, honey, you need to do the same. And if you have never prayed in the Spirit, tonight we're going to give you an opportunity before you leave to pray in the Spirit. It's awesome. So I surrender my will. That's my soul area, and that's very important. My mind, my emotions, my will. But then, in the Holy of Holies,
wow, where is the light in there? Out here, we had the sunlight. In here, we had the candlestick. But in there, where is the light? And it's the glory of God. And what part of you is this? It's your spirit. You have a spirit. And that's so key for you. Because that's where God talks to you, is in your spirit. And important for us to learn how to listen in our spirit, which means you have to shut up. And sometimes it's hard for me to shut up and listen. And so he will talk to you in your spirit. And this is my goal this year, that I hear his voice. That's my theme for Marilyn, hearing his voice, learning to hear in my spirit. And that is so important. So I'm going to tell you a couple things that I think, folks, especially since you're giving yourself to prayer in this early part of the year, learning to hear in your spirit can be key for all the time. We were in Ethiopia. We had a big meeting, big healing meeting in Ethiopia. I love Ethiopia. I've been there probably 9 times. And so we had a big meeting, 40,000 people, and a lot of people healed, a lot of people saved, and a lot of Ethiopia is Orthodox, but also a lot is Muslim. So the meeting is over. We have one day at the hotel, and we're just going to kind of rest and shop, but I wanted to see the president. So, you know, I'm really knocking at the door to get to pray for the president, because if you can get to the head of a nation, you know, that can be very key. And so I tried and tried, and they said, no, 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 you can't do it. So this day I get up in the morning, I'm relaxed, we're going to go shopping, tomorrow I'll go home. And the Lord said to me in my spirit, you're going to meet the president today. I said, good. So I called one of our staff people, our director. I said, get ready, we're going to meet the president today. He said, Marilyn, you can't meet the president today. They've already told us it's impossible. I said, but God just told me we are. And so he was just trying to be nice. He said, well, okay. What are we going to do? I said, we're going to go shopping. And I said, while we're shopping, we'll probably get a phone call. You know, so these are times when it can look like you're really crazy, right? I mean, crazy, crazy. So we're shopping, and the woman who took us, the Ethiopian woman, gets a phone call from the palace, and the president said, I would like to have tea with Marilyn today. Hearing in your spirit, that is so key. Amen? And so I want to be sensitive, don't you? And I think this, I see Asians more sensitive to listen in their spirit than Caucasians. I think we're so soulish, but Asians seem to have more of a sensitivity. Now, I've been to China 34 times. Chinese Christians, they hear in their spirit. I've been to Iran and known Christians in Iran. They hear more in their spirit. Some way, I don't know if they're trained, I don't know what it is, but they have more of a sensitivity to hear in their spirit. And I think that's very key for us to learn to hear in our spirit. Don't you? Now, you say, well, I'm not spiritual. Well, you have a spirit. And he says, my sheep know his voice. So stand up. Say, I'm his sheep. Baba. Okay, you can be seated. Now, it didn't just say shepherds here. It says sheep here. And I'm his sheep. And so that's what I do often in witnessing to someone. So I like to win people to Christ. I think it's the greatest joy there is. So I go to a real nice restaurant near where I live, an Italian restaurant. So one of the men in there, one of the waiters said to me one day, I noticed you pray over your food,
And my mother lives in Hawaii, and she's having a really hard problem. And maybe she's here tonight, I don't know. He said, would you pray for her? I said, yes. You know, write her name down. So he did. So every time I go in that restaurant, he said, you're here. Here's my prayer list. And so now, you know, I'm praying for his girlfriend, and she has arthritis. We're believing for her healing. But now he's open to come to church and to receive Jesus. But, see, this thing is contagious. So now the owner of the restaurant came up to me the other day, and he said, would you mind praying for me? He said, I had a heart attack, and I know you like to pray. So I said, yes, I do. So I got so bold, I was shocked at myself. I said, in Jesus' name, I command a new heart to come into him. Well, now the other waiters come up and say, I brought my prayer list today. I heard you were coming in. But I'm going to push it a little further, because I'm going to ask if I could come maybe once a month and have a Bible study with the waiters for 10 minutes before they begin. Why not? We have a big God. He loves people. But now I've got another restaurant cooking the same way. God is cooking, amen? And see, in your spirit, there is nothing that'll give you more joy than leading someone to Christ. There's nothing like it, because the angels have a party and it comes down on us. Right? So what's in the Holy of Holies? Where's the light? The glory of God. What's the light? Oh, what's the light in your spirit? The glory of God. And we have his glory. And I remember when Moses said, show me your glory. And God showed his goodness. The glory of God in you says, I'm a good God and I love you. And I want to show you my goodness. And so that glory is light in you. God is not out to bash you. He'll correct you. He'll deal with you. Of course, you would want him to, because he doesn't want you to crash. But he wants to show you his goodness. That's what he says in your spirit. I want to show you. I want to reveal my goodness to you. So stand up. Put your hand on your heart. You won't wear your heart out, I promise. Say, Father, I believe tonight you want to show me your goodness every day in my spirit. You're a good Father, and you love me, and you have good things for me in 2016. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah! You can be seated. Now, but actually, there are two pieces of furniture in here. Well, what are they? Well, we have the Ark of the Covenant, which you see in the book of Revelation. We see the mercy seat, which we also see in the book of Revelation, because we see all this in the book of Revelation. And so, that Ark of the Covenant is covered with gold. But inside it, it has some very special things. It has Aaron's rod that budded. It has the Ten Commandments. And it has a golden pot of manna. So what is inside the covenant? Because Jesus kept the covenant for us. Amen? He has leadership for us. Why was Aaron's rod budding? Because God wanted to show who was the priest, who was the leader. Now, folks, people can be very hang loose about church, but it's too late to tell me you can be hang loose, because I've been a pastor's wife 57 years. The people who stay close in the church and close to leadership in the church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, they're around later. And so are their children and their grandchildren. Amen? You need the church. You need the leadership of the church. You say they're not perfect. That's right, but you're not either. And they're here and appointed of God for you, for the work of the ministry, and to help you, right? And so Jesus put leadership in the body of Christ for us. But the Ten Commandments, dear Lord, I can't keep the Ten Commandments. Oh, so he said, I'll just keep them for you. And so he kept the commandments for me. He died in my place and took all of my sin and gave me all of his righteousness. And that's amazing to me. And when I say this every day, I'm so grateful to God. It says, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So put your hand on your heart. Say, because of the covenant, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And you know, sometimes when you say that, you don't feel righteous at all. And I know one time we missed a plane in Atlanta. I had to spend the night. They lost my luggage. I just want to slap everybody sideways. I'm so upset. I need to be home. And I said, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But even saying it helped me. Amen? Amen. Amen. He kept that covenant for me, and he says, I am the righteousness of God. So if he says it, is it true? When the Father sees us, does he see us as righteous? That's what he says. But then, the mercy seat. And it had two beautiful angels that faced each other. Beautiful angels. And so these angels overlooked the mercy seat. And why was the mercy seat so important? Because that's where they heard from God. God doesn't speak from the seat to condemn you. He speaks from the mercy seat, and he is merciful to you. And so they would hear his voice coming from the mercy seat. And what is that? That's your spirit. Everybody say, my spirit. When he talks in my spirit, say, when he talks to me in my spirit, he corrects me, he trains me, he directs me, he encourages me, because he speaks to me from the mercy seat. Amen. So stand up. Now, look at this. Okay, face his back for me again, okay? Look at this. What's the shape of this? It's a cross. Has he provided everything you need for 2016? In the cross? Okay, so let's just look at this with Jesus. Jesus is the perfect sacrifice. Amen? Amen. He died in our place. Okay, Jesus says he's the living word. Amen? Amen. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. Amen? Amen. Jesus says, I'm the bread of life. Amen? Jesus says he ever lives to intercede for us. Amen? 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 Jesus says, I kept the covenant for you. And Jesus says, I'm seated in heavenly places. Would you sit down with me? Amen. Amen. And so he is all of this because of the cross. Everybody say the cross. You can be seated. Now, I share this with you because I want to see you have a victorious year. And so, you know, I have the package, and I'll be happy to autograph the book. But the book has so much material. Plus, the video really helps you see it, and we've used this on television. But I also have another book called Signs in the Heavens. Now, this book is very unique. I wrote this over 40 years ago, so let me tell you about it. Do you know the horoscope is the devil's plan? The zodiac tells the story of Jesus. So I'm in Israel 40 years ago, and I went to see the Chagall windows, and they had the 12 tribes, you know, as the signs of the zodiac. And I thought, what?
Did the Jews worship the horoscope? No, no. They were the 12 tribes. So I asked the guide. He said, oh, I can take you to some of the places, you know, where they have the old synagogues. They have the 12 tribes. He said, those are the 12 tribes. So I came home and began to look at it. And I saw, and I began to study it, that the 12 signs of the zodiac tell the story of Jesus. And so wouldn't the devil like to have you do stupid horoscope things instead of seeing who Jesus is? And the very first sign is Virgo. What's Virgo? A virgin. One of the major stars in this is called the seed of the woman and has a woman holding a baby. And folks, I'm not afraid of the red moons because Jesus is it all. He is everything. So Kona, I feel led to give this to you. Do you feel led to receive it? Okay. They will bring it to you. So I will be glad to autograph it, but I'm telling you, pass it around. Get several. Don't get just one or two. Get three or four. You know, folks, we give people candy for gifts. We make them fat. We give them flowers. They will. Give them God's word and change their lives. Don't just get one set for yourself. You know people who need a new year, a good year. Get several, three or four, and let people be changed. And then I have something that's free. Everybody say free.
Free.
I have confessions of health and healing. I don't want you being sick. God doesn't want you being sick. God wants you to have health to the last day of your life. You say, how am I going to die? I don't think that's a problem. He can just take your breath. Amen? And so you will listen to these, you will speak these, you will pass them on, and all you have to do is sign a card and it's available back there. How are you doing? Did I talk too fast? Did I try to get too much into you at one time? Because I so love to teach and I love to teach in this church. Now, let me just say something to you tonight. How did I get so crazy? People say I have a crazy faith. Well, that's fine. Just don't call me crazy. But crazy faith is good. I started when I was 16. I was raised in a very liberal Methodist church. And I had a hunger to read the Bible. And I started reading the Bible when I was about 11. And they didn't teach the Bible in our church, but I liked it. And I really wanted to know about Jesus. I just didn't know you could have him inside. And so I went to a youth camp, the Baptist minister spoke, I was 16, I got born again. Now, I couldn't stay out of the Bible then because I had the author in here. And so, you know, I really had a passion for the Word of God, reading the Word. But then, when I was 23, I got Spirit-filled. And that was a whole nother level for me. That's when God began to take me to nations. That's when I began to see blind eyes open. That's when I began to see God lengthen legs, you know, and give people new hearts. You know, God has spare parts in heaven. He can give you a new heart. He can give you a new spine. I mean, the things that I have seen and experienced in my own life, they are right on, and they're the Word. And so I began to get into the realm of the supernatural, because being baptized in the Holy Spirit takes you into another realm. Am I right?
Yes.
Say amen.
Amen.
Okay. Now, how many of you here tonight would say, I'm not really sure my heart is right with God. Let's start this year with your heart in tune with God. Maybe you're backslidden. You know, you're kind of out of sync. Well, why not just recommit? Or maybe you've never received Jesus. Maybe you were like I was. I didn't know I could have him. How many of you would say, I'm just not right with God tonight. I'd like you to pray for me. Put your hand up really high. Put your hand up really high. You don't have to be embarrassed. We think you're wonderful. Just put your hand up. I want everyone with your hand up, would you just stand up? I want to get right with God. I want my heart to be right. I want to start this year with Jesus in charge of my life. That's so good. That's so good. How many of you here would say, well, I want to do that, you know, but, you know, I'm right with God, but I want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I want power in my life. How many of you in this beautiful auditorium, you've never spoken in tongues in your whole life? Put your hand up really high. I've never prayed in tongues in my whole life. I want everyone with your hand up. Would you just stand up? Just stand up. If you have your hand up in your seat, stand up. Now, I'm not through with you. I want everyone who's seated to help me. So I want you, even if you know what they'll say, I want you to turn to the right and say, do you need to stand up? I'd like to stand with you. Now turn to the left, say, do you need to stand up? I'd like to stand with you. And then just stand up. Just stand up. That's good. Wow, this is the way to start. So everyone pray with me. Say, Father, you love me. You have a wonderful plan for me. You have a divine destiny with my name on it. Tonight, I repent of all my sins. I have faith in the blood of Jesus to cleanse me from all sin. Jesus, come into my heart. Be Lord of my life. Baptize me in the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.